Hi, and welcome back to the WellBe Show and podcast. This is your host, Adrienne Nolan Smith, and I'm very excited to have another incredible, inspirational story of health recovery to share with you. Today, I have Britt Martin. She is a cancer survivor who is also able to reverse her amenorrhea, which is what we'll be talking about a lot today, and also the founder of a company called Food Period, which makes functional food products to support women with their menstrual cycle. This topic is very close to my heart as I had 2 years of amenorrhea when I was in college, and it really started me on the journey of understanding integrative and functional medicine in all the sorts of different systems in my body that were connected and would throw a period off or make it disappear altogether. So I'm very happy to have Britt here today to share her story. And without further ado, Britt, please share the whole thing. I know there's a lot there with everything you went through and cancer treatment, but please, we'd love to hear it.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me, Adrienne. So yeah, my story kind of with my health started at age 25. I'm Canadian, and so I was working in Vancouver, Canada, in finance. It was a pretty stressful job at the time, but I was an ambitious 25-year-old, and I took my job and my work really seriously and put in long hours and all that stuff. And one of the benefits of working in Canada is a lot of employers offer through their health insurance programs credits towards massage therapy. It's one of the best benefits, I'd say, that we get. And so it was nearing the end of the calendar year. It was late December, and I was looking to use up the rest of my credits. And so I was trying to book a massage, but a lot of people had the same idea. And so it was impossible to get an appointment with anyone that I had already seen. And I found registered massage therapists nearby my office and thought, like, oh my gosh, I can go on December 24th at lunchtime, and booked in. And so I went to go and see her, and I asked her to like do a little bit of work on my shoulders and my clavicle because I'd been having a little bit of tension and pain in the area, but I'd recently started boxing, so I thought it was just a result of taking up a new activity. And about halfway into our massage, she asks me if I have noticed this lump on my neck, and she takes my hand and like has me touch it and kind of run my hand over it. And I'd never noticed it, but it was about the size of a tennis ball. So I was pretty shocked to have like not noticed something like that. And she's like, well, you know, like, I think you should definitely go see your doctor, get it checked out. Like, I'd want a written note from him that it was safe to work on it before, you know, I do anything further. I'm like, okay, like, she's being awfully cautious. But I kind of was like, yeah, sure, no problem. And toward the end of the session, she just like kind of abruptly stopped the massage and was like, wow, you were really meant to come here today. And I'm like, oh, like, how do you mean? And she'd said that the appointment that I had taken, that she'd been fully booked, and this slot had just opened up because someone had canceled yesterday. And she said that I had booked into it 2 minutes after the cancellation had occurred. And it's not like I'd been waiting on something to open up. It was just when I had looked for an appointment. And so she had this kind of like spiritual sense that we were meant to meet. And I now like fully believe that. But at the time, I'm like, okay, sure. And so I left the appointment and I called my mom. She's a registered nurse, so she's kind of my go-to if I ever have any health questions. And she's like, okay, you should definitely call your doctor. I called him, but it was Christmas Eve, so he'd gone home for the holiday. And so I just kind of thought like, oh, I'll deal with it in the new year. And I went, did some Christmas shopping and headed home to my parents for Christmas Eve dinner. And I got home and I showed my mom the lump on my neck, and she turned off the stove, like put everything down, grabbed my hand and was like, we're going to the emergency room. And 6 hours later, after everything from an ultrasound all the way through to CT scan, I had the surgeon coming in from home to tell me that there was a 90% chance that I had Hodgkin's lymphoma, which is a type of blood cancer. And this was less than 12 hours since I'd had the massage. Like that morning I'd been like working on spreadsheets and like doing finance stuff, and all of a sudden I'm contending with a cancer diagnosis.
So this lump was probably like on your lymph, right? Or something?
Yeah, it was like on a lymph right on my clavicle there. And so I kind of went through the process of getting like that finalized diagnosis, and 19 days later I was starting chemo. And I had been like what I'd considered to be a healthy individual until that point. Like I was probably the most conscious about eating healthy amongst my friends. I had played volleyball throughout college and I'd always like been an active person. And so I was kind of floored that something like this could happen to someone like me that I considered like pretty healthy at the time. Like, and I remember in the process, I had asked my doctor, like, do you think that I should freeze my eggs? Like, I'm about to start 6 months of chemo. I know that this can have negative repercussions on fertility for some women. And he was just adamant about us getting started quickly and not wasting any time, because it would have pushed back the start of chemo 3 to 4 months, likely. And so we just kind of started right away. And about halfway through the process, I stopped getting my period completely. And I know, like, you know, I'd been a really good patient up until that point. Like I'd asked a lot of questions, but more so just like, what else can I do to support my health, and less questioning of like methods of treatment. And I brought my amenorrhea to my doctor and I said, I'm not getting my period, like it's completely stopped. And he said to me, like, don't even worry, it's fine. When we're finished chemo, we're just going to put you on the birth control pill to reinstate your cycle. And my jaw just dropped and I'm like, what? And for context, I had gone on the birth control pill for the first time at age 12 when I had my first period that lasted for 21 days. And like the doctors just like didn't know what to do to make it stop. So they just put me on the pill. And I'd then gone back on it at 19 when I was diagnosed with polycystic ovarian syndrome. And like my gynecologist was like, we're just going to put you on the pill. And every experience I'd had with it had not been a great one. Like it completely affected my mood. I had weight gain around it and a lot of like extreme like experiences having taken the pill. And so the idea of putting more hormones and like synthetic chemicals into my body after, you know, just completing 6 months of chemo, like seemed crazy to me. Like I couldn't even believe that that was like the solution. I think I latched on to like some aspect of this experience that I felt I could control. And for me, that was like, I'm going to get my period back in a natural way. I'm not going to use birth control like for that purpose. And so I kind of went on a journey just visiting tons of natural health practitioners. I'm sure I like kind of interviewed like a dozen of them, like everyone from a naturopath to an acupuncturist. I saw like 3 different nutritionists with different designations and a functional medicine doctor. And just, I was trying to like see and ask all these practitioners what they were doing to support women's menstrual health, in particular when they weren't getting their period for a prolonged time. And what I'd heard from a couple of them was about this practice called seed syncing. And so you eat a specific combination of seeds and you cycle them depending on which phase of the menstrual cycle you're in. And so I was like, okay, this seems like very harmless. Like it's just some seeds, like it's super natural. It's probably the most natural I can get. Let me just try it. Like there's no harm in trying it. And they'd said like, give it 3 months, it takes time. And so every day I was like scooping up my tablespoon of each seed and like grinding them up, and I'd sprinkle them on top of a smoothie bowl or like put them on a salad. And I eventually, like toward the end of the 3 months, I was making them into these energy bites that I'd like carry with me and have as my snack. And 3 months to the day, my period came back. Like it was like a perfect like example of how seed syncing can work and support women's menstrual cycles. And not only did it come back, but as I mentioned, I have PCOS. And so I'd had all these terrible symptoms. I had such painful periods. They were always super heavy. I'd had a lot of like mood swings around like menstruation, and it came back with none of those symptoms. And I was like, this is like awfully strange. Like, this is actually like an enjoyable period. And I was so shocked to not be in pain or like discomfort or, you know, feeling like a million different emotions at once and just feeling like super level. And so I like was like, wow, this like really worked. And I started telling a few of my friends about it, and like they tested it out. And shortly after, I moved to New York, and I've continued seed sinking. And then I actually like kind of just fell off the wagon of doing it, because it's a bit time consuming to like source all these seeds in their most natural form. Like, they have to be organic and raw and completely like heat treated, because you want all the nutrients to be intact. And surprisingly, you can't find all of them at Whole Foods. Like, it's, you have to go like to this like health food store and that like that different like small bodega. And so I just like found it really like time consuming. So I kind of stopped. My period was great, and then all of a sudden it stopped again. I'm like, what? Like, why did this happen? And I realized the only thing that I had changed was I had stopped seed sinking. And so I picked it back up again as like a test to just like see how good it really was, because obviously it had worked really well for me. But like, sometimes when like it's a natural thing, like, you're kind of always a little skeptical. Like, I find that like you're just like, could it really have worked, like these seeds, like in this combination, like could it really have done the trick? And so I was like, let me change nothing else, I'm just gonna like pick up seed sinking again. And so I started doing it again, and within 2 months my period was back. It was great. And so I'm like, wow, this is it, like this really works. And I thought that if a lot of women had been having the same challenge as I was, that it was time consuming and tedious and not super easy to prioritize, like making these energy bites, like if I could have bought them somewhere, like if I could have gone to Whole Foods or ordered them online or picked them up at a local coffee shop, that would have been a lot better of an experience for me. And that's kind of where the idea for Food Period was born. And so what we make are Moon Bites, and they commercialize this practice. And so we send women a monthly subscription box where they get all the seeds in perfect proportion for their whole monthly cycle.
Wow, that's an amazing story. So I have to ask about not just your period, but like how, you know, the PCOS and post chemo for cancer. I mean, these are really serious things. Like, do you end up, now that you're sort of in the world of natural therapies and, you know, believe them more? I know it's so hard to, I do this for a living, and I'm still always shocked when things I do that are natural work, because somehow there's, it's so culturally ingrained in us that like, oh, this stuff doesn't really work. And then when it does, you're like, wow, okay. Were there any connections between having, you know, 21 days of bleeding at 12 and then PCOS and then cancer at such a young age? It seems like there's some sort of, you know, there's got to be something connecting all these dots, right?
No, the challenge is that often you're not seeing one doctor or one practitioner for like everything that you're going through. Like, it's, I'm seeing a specific gynecologist for PCOS, and then like my GP is the one at 12 who's putting me on birth control, and then I'm seeing this oncologist, and like then I have my whole natural health like team that I see, from like, you know, neurological chiropractors to naturopathic doctors. And so it feels like everything's a little disconjointed, and there isn't like a system to kind of like overarchingly combine all this knowledge or insight from all of the different practitioners. And so I think that that's what I always encourage people to be, like, be that for themselves, like be your own health advocate, like have your own binder from like of all the information, like be a bit of a detective yourself. And I wish that there was a more clear-cut answer to say like why this happened, or like why at 25 I got cancer. And unfortunately, like, there isn't a clear-cut answer, which has been an interesting part of healing as well, to just like accept the unknown, and know that sometimes you're not going to have an answer and you can't retrace all your steps and perfectly align like the journey. But I think that even just like taking power back and being the like central point, being your own advocate, you're like the boss of your own health. And you know, everyone else that's working on it is like a team you assemble. I think that's just, even that gives you like solace, and or at least it does for me, and a sense of kind of control, not necessarily control, like a sense of acceptance, I would say.
Well, you are speaking my language. You know, I'm a board certified patient advocate, so I literally feel like I say it so much, it's almost annoying. Like, be, you know, the CEO of your own body, your own health. You've got to keep track of all the tests that have been done, and you investigate, you connect the dots, you find the research. Like, there's just too many disparate people working on different things in this very specialist centric system that we have set up. And like you said, even within the natural medicine side of it, you're going to have a chiropractor maybe, and also a naturopath, and maybe also an acupuncturist, and this and that. So it is really a challenge. And the answer, like you said, is that you have to be the one that cares enough and is responsible, and allow these people to be on your team, partner with you. But yeah, it's really up to us. And also because that gives you such a better sense of ownership and empowerment, instead of like, why can't everybody give me the answers? It's like, no, like, I'm going to find them, you know, just like you did when you said, I'm going to take getting my period back into my own hands. Like, I'm not, you know, this is my challenge. And so I think when we take something on as our own challenge, we have a lot better results, instead of like waiting for the victim mindset, you know, waiting for somebody to help us. Now, sometimes it can be a particular test that gives you a lot of help, right? You can't empower your way into answers that might be like, you have heavy metal toxicity. Like, how would you know that without, you know, a blood test? But maybe you could have brought some research to a particular doctor about the connection between whatever you were dealing with and heavy metal toxicity, so that they could test you for that if they hadn't been before. That's one way that like being your own investigator is so great. So you haven't been able to find some sort of link between these things. And, you know, I'm such an avid investigator that of course my mind goes there, but I also think it's so mature and also so wise. Those are similar words, I realize, that you realize the incredible need for and power of acceptance in healing. Like, wildly so. And that goes along just what I was speaking about before, this like when you release the idea of like why me or victimization, and just go into acceptance on all sides of like, these are the cards I've been dealt. This is where I am now. I'm not going to lament like why me. I was a healthy person. Like, you know, I did all the right things, but also I don't have all the answers, and I might never have all the answers. And like, that doesn't mean I can't stop healing my body by using acceptance and positivity, which science has shown has a tremendous impact on healing. Okay, so how many years have you now had like a regular period, and do you feel like you need to always stick with the seed sinking because of all the things that you've gone through, or just because you've seen that it fell off?
Yeah, it's a great question. So in terms of how long, I guess it would have been August 2016 that I got it back after I finished treatment. So I guess we're like coming up on 4 years of a regular, what I would consider a great period. We always talk about that with food period. We're like, we help women have great periods naturally. And like, people are looking at us like, are you crazy?
Like who could ever have a great period? I mean, I'm surprised.
But no, I think so. Yeah, it's been, 4 years, almost 4 years, 3.5. And so I think like in terms of the practice, I was really diligent about it for probably the first 3 years after that first time that kind of it stopped, after I'd stopped following the seed sinking practice. And then also we were developing our products at Food Period. So there was a lot of taste testing that went in there. And I wanted to make sure that everything that we developed was continuing to work for me and women in our community. And so I really followed it kind of diligently during that time. But one way that we talk about seed sinking, and a lot of practitioners talk about it this way too, is that it's kind of like a tool in your toolbox. And so like, use it when you're having kind of issues around menstruation or your menstrual cycle. And then like, if things are good for you know, 3 to 6 months. Like, you can feel free to like put it back on the shelf and, you know, pick it up later when you need it again. And so I practiced doing that myself, and I found that like my menstrual cycle continued to be great. And then recently, actually, it's interesting, probably like 4 months ago, I still was getting my regular cycle, but I was seed sinking like less regularly. Like, I sometimes like to like pull it in for a month at a time, just to like reset myself. But I had had this really stressful month work-wise. You know, we're a growing startup and there's a lot of growing pains when you're scaling a business, which is like always a good thing, but it's still growing pains. And so I'd had this really stressful month. My sleep had been off. Like, I'd maybe not been as diligent about like cooking for myself, which I now love to do. And I had noticed a few of my symptoms around menstruation come back. Like, I'd had cramps one day, and I hadn't like remembered having that in like ages. Like, I probably haven't had like proper cramps in 3 years, 3.5 years. And so I was like, oh, like, okay, this is like what we talk about when you need to now like pick it back up off the shelf. And so I like, you know, ordered myself some of our Moon Bites, and I like did another month like of it, of seed sinking, and have been doing it since. And like, it's been great. Now the symptoms have kind of like calmed down as well. So I feel like it's been great for me, and not necessarily like regulating my cycle, because I feel like it's taking care of that now, but in terms of like helping to support my body during more stressful periods of time. And so I'm a lot more proactive now. Like, I know if I have a crazy month, like I'll make sure to be diligently seed sinking throughout it.
I also just had a crazy, very stressful work month in January when we did the first live launch for our Spark Health program, which is just wrapping up now, and had a incredibly painful period in, you know, early February as a result, or mid-February. And it was just so obvious to me. Like, there was nothing else that had changed besides, you know, this crazy amount of stress. And then with that, not having time to do my regular like morning meditation and things like that. And it was just like, bam, like that was very eye-opening. Cause I was still taking, you know, some supplements that I thought would help and all that, but it was just like, the stress was clearly the killer. Yeah. And I think not enough women understand the connection between a painful period or a regular period or things like around menstruation and around hormonal imbalance. Well, they get that part because hormones are involved, but how much, first of all, your gut impacts your hormones and how much stress impacts your gut. So it's like this cascading effect. And once you sort of like, you know, my dad used to always say about government corruption, like follow the money. It's like, follow the trail. Like, what affects what, you know, like you've got a painful period. You know, that means something's up with your hormones, something's up with your gut. If something's up with your gut, something's up with your, you know, usually what's causing gut problems. And there's a variety of things that can cause gut problems, but stress is one of them. Again, putting on our kind of like investigator hat, I'm always so interested and curious about like the root cause of whatever. But like you said, there's occasions in our lives where, yes, we know stress is the root cause, and we can do better things for stress management, but that's not going to change that we're going up against that big launch or that big test we have to take or something where there's going to be some stress, you know, or mm-hmm. something that happens in your family that you just can't control that's going to cause great stress. And so it's great to have tools in your toolbox just for that, those times, while also being a great investigator and always trying to understand the root cause of things. So tell me a little bit about your PCOS now, because that's something that a lot of women, you know, who are Wellbe fans struggle with. And it's, I think there's very little as far as answers about root causes in the conventional healthcare world. So I'd love to know kind of like how chemo affected that, if at all, or how kind of not having cancer anymore affected that, and all of the above.
Yeah, so I was diagnosed with PCOS when I was 19, probably a late diagnosis given like the period problems that I'd had throughout my teen years. But I finally went to like get the diagnosis or like pursue a diagnosis or some sort of help from a gynecologist when I was in college. And I had like this had never really happened to me before, but I'd started to get like a few like thick, coarse hairs, like at different parts around like my jawline and, you know, obviously as 19-year-old, you're concerned about appearance and like something like that is like a little horrifying to a 19-year-old. And so I was like, oh my gosh, well now like this I can't deal with. Like I have to go and get some support. Like
it's always the cosmetic that drives people to make the changes. It's like, oh, well, nothing is right inside my body. But the second I gain weight, like, okay, I want to do something about this. You know, it's like.
100%. Yeah, that's exactly what happened. Like the years of like not being able to leave bed on the first day of menstruation, like that wasn't enough, but the small like chin hairs were. And so I got the diagnosis first then. And I remember sitting, like I can literally pull myself back into this waiting room and into this like medical office, and I'm waiting for the test results for the gynecologist to come in, and I'm sitting there and she comes in and she explains to me that I have PCOS, and she draws this like kind of circle on a piece of paper and shows how most normal people have like one large follicle that develops during their cycle, and people with polycystic ovarian syndrome, like she like dots all these dots over the circle and explains that like, oh, you have a lot of follicles but none of them fully develop. And I was like, okay, I'd never heard of this, like tell me more. And I was like, well, what do we do for this? She's like, we're gonna just put you on the birth control pill. That'll totally take care of the symptoms. Your hairs will go away and, you know, you'll be feeling better in no time. And I'm like, okay, I've taken the birth control pill before. I haven't like felt great. And she's like, well, we'll put you on this one. It has less symptoms, all this. And I remember before I left, I'd asked her about like if this affects my ability to have children or anything like that. And it's interesting because my parents actually, when they were trying to conceive, it took them, I think, 13 years until they were able to conceive me. And I think my mom now looking back was like, oh, I 100% had polycystic ovarian syndrome and it was just like undiagnosed or missed. So it's clearly maybe something that has a hereditary link between us. Also, like the investigator in me is like, oh, where did this come from? And so I always like remembered my mom telling me that story. I'm an only child. And so like, I'd always thought like, oh, it was like really hard for them to get pregnant. And so I, for some reason that like popped into my mind. And so I asked the gynecologist and she's like, yeah, like you might never be able to have children. It's probably going to be really hard for you. So you should just like know that. And like, then she left and I was like, what? Like, at 19, you're kind of like given this information. And although like having children and having a family isn't really pertinent to my everyday life or like thoughts too far like in the future, it's still pretty shocking to like hear that information and then just be asked to accept it without any kind of like solution or anything that I could start doing at age 19 to like promote that ability. And so that's kind of like my journey with the diagnosis. And now that I think back, it's kind of a similar like innate, almost like natural shock that I also had to my oncologist's suggestion of the birth control pill for reinstating my cycle. And so I think it's been interesting to see like just my ability as I've grown up to better trust my intuition and those like body, like gut check reactions to things and like trust them instead of just dismissing them. Because I took the pill after seeing her and getting this diagnosis for 6 months. And I like, it was a really wild 6 months. I felt like I had brain fog throughout, super like moody with my mood swings. My chin hairs did disappear, but my menstrual cycle was all over the place still. And so I just kind of stopped taking it and just decided that I would live with the symptoms of PCOS and kind of just accepted them. And it wasn't really until after going through cancer and chemo and, you know, having missed my period that I started to really focus on like the quality of my period and its regularity and that sort of thing. And so it's interesting that the PCOS hadn't been enough of a trigger to make me seek a natural solution, but it might've just also been my age.
I mean, looking back to myself in college, going through the same amenorrhea type stuff, like, first of all, your parents have been in charge, you know, before that. And so you don't feel empowered. And then I think women especially don't feel empowered in that scenario. And there's just a sense of like, I've been told I should just worry about going to class and like having a good time in college. And so I don't really want to deal with these other things and take them on and, you know, investigate and do the lifestyle changes that might be necessary to actually deal with them. I just kind of want to like pretend they're not happening. So I've seen many stories of women kind of getting to their early mid-20s and things come crashing down. Another story that we told for Welby is a friend of mine, Phoebe Lapine, who's like a food and, you know, a kind of wellness blogger, author too. Same thing. She'd had a diagnosis, you know, earlier, maybe she was 20 or something, and plenty of the symptoms, but just kind of was like trying to ignore, trying to not deal, and trying to also say they were normal somehow, or like, oh, everyone deals with this, or, you know, there's a lot of like, acceptance is such a good thing for healing, because there's nothing better than accepting the situation as is and then trying to improve it. But accepting that you're just going to have to live in misery is no bueno. I mean, that just makes the situation worse and worse and worse over time till it's, you know, a much more serious problem. But a lot of women do that. You know, a lot of us just kind of like find a way to manage. It's actually much better if you can get to things earlier. You know, it's a lot easier to reverse a small chronic health issue than it is a chronic illness. Like, you are a perfect example. Like, had you at 19 or even at 12, if someone was like, why is this child having a period for 21 days? Like, that's bizarre. Let's look into what might be going on here, and found whatever that initial root cause was, you might never have gotten into a PCOS situation or maybe even cancer, right? Because your body was fighting another battle. So yeah. It couldn't really deal with two fronts. It's really hard to fight a war on two fronts. Of course, we can't know, but I think about things like that for a lot of people.
I totally agree too, because I feel like, especially as women, we're told like, oh, your period's meant to be like a miserable time of the month. And like yeah. everyone gets cramps. Everyone feels uncomfortable. Everyone's like super bloated and moody and can't sleep and all these things. And we're told that just because these symptoms are common, that like somehow we like should accept them as normal, and they're actually not normal. Like, you're not meant to be in miserable pain throughout your menstrual cycle. And I think that it's so interesting, and also like speaks so much to just like the change in society and culture, that I'm so happy that there are spaces where we can talk about periods so openly. And I mean, we thought it would be super awkward to talk to women about their periods in the beginning when we first started Food Period. And there's just been so much progress, I think, on this front, in that like, we shouldn't have to accept this. And like, we shouldn't have to accept that the only solution for managing period pain is the birth control pill. Like, there's not nearly enough innovation in this space. And it's largely because I believe a lot of the research efforts are male-led and focus less on the symptoms of women and supporting our kind of pain points throughout the cycle. Yeah, exactly what you said, like, acceptance definitely has its place, but also like, I think only when you've kind of tested and tried and investigated all of these different areas first.
I think male-led and also industry-led, right? Like, the birth control pill is a really big industry, and you can't patent seeds, right? So you're never going to be able to charge $1,000 for seeds. I think there's part of it too. You know, economics, unfortunately, drive a lot of this.
That's actually something, because, I mean, just early on when we were building our company, we had a lot of investor meetings, and something investors would always say to us is like, well, where's all the science behind this? And we're like, tried to explain to them as best that we could. And like, once you think about it logically, it makes a lot of sense. But seed thinking is a practice that's natural and known. Like, you can't patent like seed thinking as a process. You can't patent like a recipe around an energy bite. Like, it's not that unique or like unknown, that the economic kind of impetus to study it. And so just because like a pharmaceutical company, and pharmaceutical companies lead almost all of these major scientific studies, because there's no economic like benefit for them studying this, like, of course there's not research like in depth. And so a lot of the research ends up being anecdotal, which, I mean, for me is compelling enough, but I know that like for not everyone, that's the case.
Yeah, so I was just going to say, because we cover a lot of research at Welby. It's something that's really important to me, because I'm sick and tired of hearing that, you know, natural medicine, integrative, functional medicine, whatever, doesn't have scientific backing, because academic medical institutions, some of the most famous ones that you can think of, Stanford, Johns Hopkins, Northwestern, whatever, they're doing fantastic research that supports a lot of what natural medicine stands for, especially on the mind-body stuff, on the food, on the environmental toxicity stuff, all of that. So I think there's actually a lot more research than there ever has been. But like you said, female health lacks a lot of funding dollars. And although maternal health is getting a lot more good research, you know, we do this thing called the Wellbe Wrap-Up, which is a news and research wrap-up from the previous 2 months. And we kind of, you know, make it like bite-sized and really understandable. And there's just so much great research coming out about pregnancy and also like early life and breastfeeding. And if the women were exercising, like the toddler's cognitive development 3 years later is like different. I mean, it's pretty cool. Yeah. But nothing really pre-pregnancy, which is why the world of endometriosis, PCOS, just like, you know, things in that family of diseases are so frustrating because there just isn't a ton of research being done on it. That being said, is there any research, like was there any, you know, academic medical institution that ever kind of studied seed sinking? Like I, you know, I care about that stuff. So I'd love to know, are there any even small studies that have been done?
Yeah, it's interesting. So there's studies on different seeds and how they interact with like the female menstrual cycle. And so like there'll be studies on flax seeds. Actually, flax is probably one of the most well studied because the four seeds that are used in seed sinking are flax seeds and pumpkin seeds during the first phase, the follicular phase. So from menstruation through to ovulation. And then the other two seeds are sunflower seeds and sesame seeds. And those are daily from ovulation until your next cycle. And so flax is actually one of the probably most well-studied seeds, and largely because it's also used for women going through perimenopause or menopause. And so there's kind of this like dual use case for flax. And so it has lignans in it, in the hull of the seed, that have phytoestrogen properties. So they're shown to kind of bind to estrogen receptors and help the body's elimination of excess estrogen, which is a big problem in the Western world. And so flax is probably like the hero of the scientific research around seed sinking. But what we've done actually is we had MPA student at NYU go through and do like a scientific literature review of every single seed and their micronutrients and kind of cross-reference those with studies that focus specifically on the menstrual cycle. And so we actually have on foodperiod.com a seed sinking tab. And if you go down, you can look at every single seed, their micronutrients or chemical compounds. And then we have links to all of the studies that have been done on those specific micronutrients or chemical compounds and how they interact and can improve women's menstrual cycles. So it's interesting because it's very much very similar to the investigative mindset we've taken with you and I have taken with our health and a lot of other women I know out there. In that, like, you kind of have to understand what's happening hormonally during each phase. And then, like, you take our understanding of the menstrual cycle and, like, you layer in our understanding of these micronutrients and kind of you overlay each of them over each other. And it makes complete logical sense then. And so I'd say from a literature review perspective, there's a lot, but nothing, like, specifically saying, like, this study, it hasn't been studied with, you know, 100 women for, like, this many months. And that's definitely something we hope to contribute to. We've done home use tests actually within our own community where we took a group of like 10 users and had them seed sink for 3 months and collected kind of data from them. But it's hard to do something. It's like, I understand why there is so much structure that and rigor that needs to go into this, because sometimes people wouldn't respond to surveys, or, you know, like maybe somebody would miss taking their moon bites for a week, and then that throws off your like results or data. And so it's been an interesting journey learning how to best communicate all of that stuff.
Yeah, I mean, you're a small business owner, like to also do rigorous scientific research at the same time is really hard. So I don't doubt that it was a challenge and that people, you know, user error and all of that, totally. But still, I mean, you guys should pound on the door of some, you know, centers studying female health or whatever else to get them to do it, because I think that would just be really cool to show people. Two more questions for you on the seed sinking, because I think it's really interesting to people. And I think a lot of people watching this, myself included, are like, should I be doing that? So the first thing is, can you just give like a 30-second explanation of how it actually works? And then also, if, you know, what it's really best for besides, of course, getting your menstrual period back. If you have a regular menstrual period, are there any other things related to your period that it has been shown to be useful for?
Definitely. Yeah. So basically the way that the practice works kind of from a like at home, how you would do it yourself is you take flax seeds and pumpkin seeds during the first phase of your menstrual cycle. So from the first day of your period daily, you would take a tablespoon of each. They have to be, like I mentioned previously, organic, raw, and then they need to be freshly ground.
Okay. So ground, not just eating
seeds. Yeah. They have to be ground because that's like making the micronutrients and chemical compounds more bioavailable, like in your gut.
Helping. Oh, interesting. Okay. And why raw? Exactly. Just because you told me this before, right? The heat kills some of the micronutrients.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Exactly. So, and then obviously organic because we want to just try to avoid any pesticides or like environmental toxins, which can be
right. And tablespoons aren't, I mean, now that I know they're ground, it's a little different, but a tablespoon is hardly anything. That's pretty amazing.
Yeah, it's not like nothing crazy. And so, yeah, you would eat that every single day for 14 days. And then at ovulation, like if you're already tracking your cycle, you can literally like perfectly time it if you know exactly when you're ovulating and that sort of thing. But most women don't. And so what you would do is on day 15, then you switch to a tablespoon of sunflower seeds and sesame seeds, freshly ground, organic, raw. And then you have those every day for 14 days. And then you restart at your next period. If you're getting a regular period, or if you're not getting a regular period, we just say restart after day 28. And you're just kind of training your body to like kind of be in this rhythm. And oftentimes like it'll help support getting back to that normal cycle. And as I mentioned, each seed has a micronutrient or chemical compound that's supportive of the hormone levels during the different phases of your cycle. So in the first phase, estrogen's high. And so like the seeds that you're taking are supportive of its production and then elimination. And then in the second phase, your progesterone spikes and your estrogen is low. And so the seeds that you're taking are supportive of like estrogen elimination during that phase and like part of the building blocks of progesterone. And so, yeah, it's a really amazing practice also in the sense that like you're supporting the hormones in the menstrual cycle. And so a lot of the problems that we as women deal with, whether it's like in a regular cycle, a missing period, or something as simple as like hormonal acne, or I shouldn't say as simple because that's not fun to deal with. I've been there. But hormonal acne or cramps or, you know, back pain, those sort of things, like those are all manifestations of underlying hormonal imbalance. So we're not like targeting necessarily like the symptom, but we're actually like looking to support the underlying balance of your estrogen and progesterone levels during your cycle, which for women, depending on how that manifests as a symptom, can benefit you in different ways. So actually one of the surprising things, I wasn't getting hormonal acne when I started seed sinking. So I hadn't thought of it as being one of like the main benefits, but one of the first things that our community and customers have told us is that one of the first improvements that they see is in their skin. And so it's like probably the quickest thing to adjust to this practice. And I think because you're also getting a lot of like essential fatty acids in these seeds. And so they're supportive to just hormone production in general in the body.
Okay, so getting your menstruation back, but then it sounds like also improving your skin. Any other anecdotal benefits that your community has told you?
Yeah, like I think also the quality of their period has like improved in general. Like we have quite a few testimonials around that, and that, you know, people might have had spotting on either ends of their menstrual cycle before, or it would have always like ranged kind of between like 3 to 7 days, and they never really knew how long. And so I think it's just like kind of improving the quality. So now like it's a 5-day menstrual cycle and they're just like a medium heaviness kind of throughout versus like having tons of blood clots and like wearing like 3 pairs of things, like so that you don't have to like, you know, you're like scared to go out in public. And so things like that. And then also one of the most exciting things that we hear from our customers is our biggest reason for cancellation is actually we're a subscription. So if women cancel, one of the biggest reasons that we hear in, because we ask for you to write in and tell us like why or like what can we do to improve, and it's that women are getting pregnant. And so it's actually like a terrific tool, because I think often we aren't taught this association that like having a regular healthy menstrual cycle is like an amazing precursor to like supporting fertility. And like, if you just focus on that alone, like you're focused on fertility, like it's an amazing side benefit there. And so, and it also helps women get more in tune with their cycle. Like I never like thought about when I was ovulating before or understanding like, oh, why am I craving dark chocolate more during this time of the month? Like, it's just, you feel a lot more connected to your body. And I think only good things can come from that.
Well, that is an amazing note to end on, because I have to agree. I think I'm going to go have to get some moon bites for sure, because one, like you said, flax has so many other health benefits. I have, you know, some thyroid issues and I'm always reading about and kind of figure out the root causes and things that really support your thyroid and your adrenals and all that. And flax is definitely one of them. So it's just, it seems like you said, why not? You know, it's just supportive of so many different things, even if you get a regular period or aren't trying to get pregnant or any of that. So it's foodperiod.com is where people can find these products and, you know, connect with your community. So my last question for you before we go is, and we ask this for all of our Wellbee interviews, and I kind of feel like I know what you would say based on this, but if there's anything else, let us know. How do you get Wellbee? So, you know, our hashtag and website and all of our social channels are Get Wellbee. And we like the get part because, like you said, it has a sense of empowerment of taking control, taking action to have good health. Good health does not just happen, right? You really have to work at it. And so what are the things that you do every single day that when you miss them, you really feel off to really keep yourself well, especially post cancer and PCOS and all these things that you're like, all right, this is my thing.
I'd say that I get Wellbee by starting my day with like a warm hot cup of matcha and a bit of journaling. I think that that's the best way for me to like get my mind in the right space, like get any like fears or anxieties, any stressors out on the page. And I really feel like I leave it there, and having the matcha or hot beverage feels like a bit of a treat while I get to do that. And so I love starting my day that way. And I notice when I do that, like physically and mentally, I feel better throughout the day. I'm more agile in adjusting to challenges or things that come up. And I find on days when I don't make time to do that, or I'm rushed out the door, I just feel a little less grounded. So I'm all about doing things that proactively help you feel better. I think that's the best way. And it's so challenging as an entrepreneur, as you know, especially in this health space, you know, all these things that make you feel better, that help you live a better life, that, you know, help you get Wellbee. I think that sometimes it's hard to prioritize them when there's so much on your plate and you're so focused on like helping and supporting your community, and you really have to take care of yourself first. And so I'm always trying to remind myself of that in order to help others.
Absolutely. I love starting your day out with journaling and something that feels like a treat, but that's also like a pretty healthy treat. That's awesome. So Britt, thank you so much for sharing your story with me and the Wellbee community. It's an incredible story, and your perseverance through PCOS and cancer and all the pain you've experienced and doctors and all of that. And one, taking the reins and saying like, I'm going to solve at least this period issue. And then successfully doing that and then, you know, turning that positive experience into helping others have the same and create this great company is just a wonderful thing for everybody. So thank you for all the work that you do.
Well, thank you as well. Like, and thank you for creating this space to like tell these stories and share them as well, because I think it helps us all feel a little less alone.
Oh, well, thank you. That is definitely a part of it. I want to help women see who've had, you know, PCOS or issues with their menstruation, that there are ways of dealing with it beyond the pill, and that there's things to try that also have no side effects. You know, there's eating your seeds, which are full of nutrients, is just helpful in so many aspects. And your diet and the micronutrients that you have really depict how your systems and your organs function. So knowing that, you can support them in such a easy way. I mean, taking a tablespoon of seeds a day, like, come on, think about all the things you've done that are so much more challenging than that in your life. So I think that's awesome. So thank you so much again.
Thank you.